Hey everybody, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. We are going to talk about Broadcom after their last earnings update. Here's what we'll talk about in today's brief video. Think of this almost as like a precursor to NVIDIA GTC, GPU Technology Conference. First, why is Broadcom stock outperforming its peers in recent months? Second, this company does a lot with AI, both semiconductors and software. And finally, what will propel this investment higher in 2025 and beyond? Those are our key points for Broadcom in 2025. But first, a word from the sponsor of today's video, finchat.io. If you're a frequent viewer of our research here at Chipstock Investor, you know that we embed FinChat charts into our research process from top to bottom. You can make charts like this one comparing different similar investments to each other. It's a great way to get comparative analysis, everything from just simple straight stock price or total return. Or if you want more detail on that, you can compare things like forward expected price to free cash flow. Or if you want to get even more granular than that, things like return on invested capital. There's also a great new feature called custom metrics, where if you have a particular financial metric that you use to track your favorite business, you can actually input that into FinChat and it will chart it for you back in time, and then it will save it so you can continue to track that metric going forward. A lot of great stuff happening in FinChat. We'll be using a number of charts in this video today. You can get started using it for free. Check the link below, finchat.io/CSI. And if you do opt for a paid plan, you can get 15% off. finchat.io/CSI. This is something that I think has been missed by a lot of investors as of late. Semiconductor stocks actually are still off their all-time peak that was set all the way back in July 2024. Yeah, that's right. We still have not re-achieved all-time highs for chip stocks, not even in December and January when the market overall was pushing its way to new all-time highs. You can blame the downturn in key parts of the semiconductor industry, a sluggish return to growth for consumer electronics like PCs and laptops, and of course, the auto, industrial, and power chip market still trying to find a bottom. So a lot of these stocks have been clobbered well off their all-time peak. That, of course, includes NVIDIA stock, but take a look at Broadcom, bucking the trend here versus a lot of its peers and competitors. Yes, it has been hit by the recent market correction, but it is greatly outperforming the semiconductor ETFs, SOXX, SMH, and XSD. Why is that the case? Let's review the last couple of quarters to get us up to speed with where we are today here in mid-March 2025. These were the revenue results in Q4 fiscal 2024, 3 months ended in October of 2024. Bear in mind the specific numbers for the end market sales are gone now. So this Q4 2024 report was the last time CEO Hock Tan gave us specific numbers on all of the specific end markets. But at the time, the big takeaway here was the AI networking portion of the networking business was the part that was in high growth mode, still in high growth mode, and expected to be up 65% year over year in Q1, the most recent quarter. Hock Tan said this rapid growth was due to the shipment of their XPUs, or accelerated processing units, and their application-specific integrated circuits designed by their big hyperscaler customers, the biggest of which, of course, is Alphabet's Google and Google Cloud, the TPU, the Tensor Processing Unit. Those are designed with Broadcom IP. Also important, infrastructure software, the last line item there, growing at a triple-digit pace last year. That's because of the acquisition of VMware. We were still lapping the prior year, fiscal 2023, when VMware was not part of Broadcom yet. So that's why there was such a big growth rate. But Q1 fiscal 2025 was going to be the first quarter where we had a like-to-like comparison. Broadcom's infrastructure software was going to have VMware in it from the year prior as well. And a lot of investors missed this. The expectation was still for 41% year-over-year growth. So how did Broadcom actually do in this most recent quarter? Here are the new reporting units as of fiscal 2025. And you can see that Broadcom exceeded expectations both in AI semiconductors and infrastructure software. AI semis grew 77% year over year, and they expect another 44% year over year increase in Q2. That's the current quarter that goes through spring of calendar year 2025. Broadcom, of course, not immune to the downturn still taking place in most of the semiconductor market. Their non-AI semiconductors down 20% year over year. They are, like much of the industry, excluding accelerated computing and AI, still waiting for that U-shaped recovery in its end markets. Enterprise computing and cloud XAI chips, some good news here, still heating up again, 2-3 quarters in a row now. So that is fantastic news for the non-AI part of chip business. But notice the infrastructure software part of Broadcom, including VMware, 47% year over year, exceeding expectations, $6.7 billion revenue in Q1, and another 23% year over year increase expected in the next quarter. So Hock Tan has been explaining for the better part of a year now the reason why this software segment is growing so quickly. There are two main reasons here. First, they're moving a lot of the existing VMware customers from a perpetual license to a cloud subscription model. Not the most popular move, but obviously working great for Broadcom. VMware was not being properly monetized in its form prior to Broadcom's takeover. Those assets are now being more properly monetized. And the other reason for growth is the AI foundation portion of VMware, which was announced with NVIDIA coming up on 2 years ago, summer of 2023. A lot of Broadcom's hyperscaler customers using that to create their own private cloud, private data center where their data is hosted on premises. It's made private, not hosted in a public cloud. So a lot of good stuff happening there. None of this was new information for longtime shareholders. CEO Hock Tan called this out a year ago in Q1 fiscal year 2024. Broadcom has continued to deliver on its promises to properly monetize VMware and get that AI foundation with NVIDIA up and running. As more of those GPUs are installed in data centers, they need virtualized, just like the traditional cloud does, based on CPUs. And I will mention right here, this is a question that continues to come up very frequently, more than 2 years into this whole accelerated computing and AI phenomenon. Is Broadcom competing with NVIDIA? They are not competitors as much as they are complementary peers. And the AI foundation that Broadcom and NVIDIA work on together is just one proof of that. These companies design different types of chips that address different parts of the data center. And of course, the different software offerings that both Broadcom and NVIDIA have also do not compete with each other. Complementary peers helping their customers in this new era of AI and accelerated computing in the data center. So let's turn a moment here to our end market cycle chart for the semiconductor industry. We did share this with our subscribers over on Semi Insider and described some of our thinking behind updating this chart from a few months ago, but let's just focus on the top line there, accelerated computing and AI infrastructure. We did change this from maximum growth in the current cycle trend to potentially slowing growth. The reason for that is we're now more than 2 years into the rollout of accelerated computing and AI in the data center. This is no longer a brand spanking new market, and the growth rates for NVIDIA and Broadcom have been slowing down. That's just normal and natural. We can't expect these companies to grow at a triple digit rate for forever when selling their AI chips. That said, there is potential here for Broadcom, much like NVIDIA, as they ramp up their new products with their hyperscaler customers to potentially re-accelerate that growth rate later on in 2025. So we'll keep everybody updated on that. Check out Semi Insider for our latest research notes on this. But in the meantime, for Broadcom, some of those hyperscaler customers are just beginning to send their application-specific integrated circuit and XPU designs to the manufacturing floor, and that is beginning to kick in higher profit for Broadcom as they do so. They're beginning to monetize the IP as those designs get actually produced and installed in data centers. So this is great news for Broadcom's profit growth story. Now, historically, Broadcom and Hochtan have been big proponents of merchant silicon or general purpose chips and computing systems that can be bought off the shelf and used as is by customers. Now, he is starting to change his tune a bit here. Broadcom obviously getting a huge tailwind in these XPUs and ASICs, application specific integrated circuits, or just custom silicon. Broadcom licensing out its very large portfolio of IP so that these hyperscaler customers can go out and design these chips specifically for a large workload that they have in their data centers. And for many of these big data center operators, spending the extra money on designing an ASIC for big AI inference workloads is going to make a ton of sense. So to date, NVIDIA's GPUs serve a different purpose. They tend to be for cutting-edge research and training of new and advanced, very large AI models. Broadcom ASICs, on the other hand, usually for a more specific workload. We'll see how this dynamic plays out over time. Perhaps there will be growing competition between NVIDIA and Broadcom as the years go by. But up to this point, this is an area where a lot of media headlines steer investors wrong into thinking that Broadcom is somehow encroaching on NVIDIA's turf. And up to this point, these have been more complementary businesses with each other. Now, there is one other key difference here between these two businesses. Admittedly, Broadcom and the management team don't always exactly know what their hyperscaler customers are designing these ASICs for. Once they get manufactured and installed into the data center, Broadcom isn't specifically aware of what those ASICs are running, which workload is actually being operated. In contrast, NVIDIA, thanks to its software algorithm library, that they keep rolling out new libraries to help companies with very specific needs, very specific AI training that they need to get done. NVIDIA tends to know more specifically what their customers are doing with their GPUs. So this is potentially a bonus that NVIDIA has as it grows its business in this accelerated computing era versus Broadcom, specifically gearing its IP towards those large hyperscalers that have the deep pockets to go out and design these chips themselves using Broadcom's technology. Either way, we see a lot of room for both businesses to continue succeeding. Let's talk about a few valuation notes here and some key points that we're watching in 2025, some catalysts that need to happen to drive the stock higher. In this chart, the bars are Broadcom's balance sheet. In red is total debt and blue cash and short-term investments. In the year since VMware was acquired, Broadcom has been paying off sizable amounts of debt. That has continued. And because of the high rate of free cash flow generation at Broadcom, the cash and short-term investments on hand have stayed stable. The orange line there at the bottom is free cash flow generated, and the purple line, the actual free cash flow margin. This is over the last trailing 12 months, Broadcom reapproaching a 40% free cash flow margin. Now, an important thing that we'll continue to point out here, as we have in the past, the free cash flow profitability from Broadcom is exceptionally good, especially for a company that still stilts more towards semiconductor sales than it does software. But because of that high burden of debt, this should still be viewed more of a value stock and less a high growth business. And that's in spite of what you may see if you look at trailing price to earnings and price to free cash flow metrics. treat this as a value stock, despite the high looking multiples. Now, the high PE and the high price to free cash flow on a trailing basis is due to effects of that VMware purchase. That was a very large acquisition, and there are ongoing expenses that are still getting worked off. So bear that in mind, but improving profit margin is going to be a key catalyst driving Broadcom stock going forward. So now let's look at the same chart, but instead of on a trailing 12-month basis, let's look at the quarterly pace of progress over the last couple of years. There you can see the steady pay down of debt in red, debt peaking at well over $70 billion after the VMware purchase, now approaching $60 billion in debt, just $9.3 billion in cash at the end of Q1. So again, high burden of debt, that is a big potential risk for Broadcom stock. But do take a look at that free cash flow margin improvement. As VMware continues to get integrated and updated, there's still more work to be done here. Hock Tan said that they're only about 60% finished migrating customers over to the cloud subscription model. And of course, AI Foundation, they believe, still has a long runway of adoption. But the goal here for Broadcom is to keep driving that free cash flow margin back towards the 50% plus rate before the VMware takeover. So just a few of our assumptions here that we use to judge Broadcom stock and whether or not we should keep buying it. It's one that we've had in our portfolio for many years, but over the next 5 years, as the AI semiconductor segment matures, VMware updates start to cool off, we'd expect Broadcom revenue growth to revert back to close to an industry average growth rate of about 7% per year. And that would be down from the approximately 18 to 20% we have penciled in for this fiscal year 2025. Now, more modest revenue growth in the years ahead is okay if Tan and the Broadcom management team can generate another roughly 10 percentage points of free cash flow margin expansion over the course of the next few years, going from 40% currently in the last quarter back up to 50% or even more. That margin expansion will make up a great deal from the slowing revenue growth rate. So again, remember, this should be treated as a value stock. And as long as the revenue growth can stay consistent and the profit margins also consistently rise, we think Broadcom stock is still a pretty good long-term buy. We called this out as a top stock to buy in the semiconductor industry all of last year and the year before that, and this still ranks very highly on our list. Check out Semi Insider for more information on that. And of course, NVIDIA GTC is coming up this week. We will have coverage of that. Check out the Semi Insider newsletter. It's a weekly newsletter. It's free. We just started it. Sign up in the link below. Real quick and easy process to get an overview of everything we cover in the week. And we have more good stuff being worked on right now for Semi Insider subscribers. Get access to all of our show notes, including these, before the videos come out, all of our research, which goes far beyond what we're able to do in video format, and weekly live Q&A sessions over on our Discord server. Check that out. It's just 10 bucks a month. We've been told it adds a great deal of value. We'll be back soon. Casey will be with me for the next videos that we do. I'm sure we will be doing some NVIDIA GTC coverage in the week ahead. So stay tuned for that. Thanks everybody for watching. Till next time. Thank you.